These are tough times for car companies. It's getting more and more difficult to get new models out there and to get consumers to pay attention to them. But I'm not talking about closing factories and cheap imports from China or overflowing dealer inventories. I'm talking about names. It is really, really hard to come up with a name for a new model that hasn't been taken already. See, back in the day, we had the Ford Mustang, the Chevy Impala, the Pontiac Firebird, the AMC Gremlin. Okay, so that wasn't such a good one, but at least that car had a name. And you got to be very careful with what you call your new model, because we now live in a global marketplace. Many languages are spoken on this planet. General Motors famously tried to market the Chevy Nova as a world car. But no one apparently told them that Nova meant no go in Spanish. Yeah, that car did well in Madrid. So, auto manufacturers are left with several options. They can recycle a name from the past, like the Chevy Malibu. They can make up a word, like the Toyota Yaris, which is a combination of the German word for yes, ja, and Charis, a Greek goddess who symbolized elegance and beauty. Or they can just abandon names altogether and go with numbers and alphanumerics. See, you can't trademark numbers, hence the BMW 323i, the Mercedes SL500, and the Volvo S40, or the Ford Model T, for that matter. Whatever the case, finding a name costs a manufacturer millions of dollars and involves focus groups and branding studios and nomenclature experts and linguists, graphic design artists, and more. So coming up with a name for a new car is really, really hard. But I think finding a name for a new car isn't as hard as coming up with a name for your band. Now, true, there have been hundreds of car models over the last half century, but there have probably been millions of rock and roll bands since the 1950s. So what's a musician to do? Well, like many things in life, we can learn by studying examples and lessons from the past. This is Naming Your Band, Part 2.
Now, the ongoing history of new music.
I was on the outside when you stayed.
too, and I will follow. And I will explain why I played that song in just a second. Welcome again. I'm Alan Cross, and this is the second half of a show studying band names. We've even come up with a proper word for this discipline, bandominology. One of the people who helped coin this word is a guy from Sausalito, California, named Mark Hershon. He operates a place called Simmer Branding. And Simmer Branding is hired by companies when they need to name a new product. When Research in Motion needed a name for the new communications device, they turned to Mark, who gave them the name BlackBerry. When Procter & Gamble invented a dusting cloth, Simmer came up with the name Swiffer. And the Saturn SUV called the View, V-U-E, that's Mark and Simmer Branding. So thanks to Mark for this, and a variety of academics, including Dr. Sheila Embleton at York University, we all got together through email, and we invented this word for the English language, bandominology. It's the study of the origins of band names. So pass that on, and maybe one day we'll end up in the Oxford English Dictionary. Okay, back to you two. Since the name of a band is also its brand name, hey, you got to think about the marketing possibilities because it's all about being more memorable. I'm surprised that more bands haven't gone the route of the advertising agency. After all, people in the ad game are pros when it comes to naming and marketing products. So it may surprise you that U2 was actually named with the help of an ad agency. They tried using names like Feedback and The Hype, but no one seemed satisfied by that, Bono especially. Too punk rock, he said, of all those names. So it was Adam Clayton who took on the project of finding a new name. He called the son of a family his parents hung out with. His name was Steve Averill. Now, Steve, or Steve Rapid, as he was known to the kids, played in a band called Radiators from Space. Now, that wasn't a great name, but Steve also worked as a graphic design artist for a place called Arrow Publishing in Dublin. Adam said, "Steve, we need a new name. Can you help us?" So Steve, the ad guy, thought it over, and he agreed that The Hype wasn't very good. Steve then offered the group six possibilities, including the Blazers and the Flying Tigers and U2. Now, the group chose U2 for a couple of reasons. Number one, it was a reference to an American spy plane that used to take high-altitude photographs over the Soviet Union and Cuba, which was kind of cool. And Adam was really into airplanes. Number two, Bono thought it sounded kind of like U-boat, the Nazi submarines of World War II. Number three, it could be interpreted as being inclusive, as in, there's me and you too. Number four, Steve showed how the letter U and the numeral two lent itself to good logo and graphic design, which is really important. And number five, it wasn't a the name. At the time, bands were the this and the that, and that was getting boring. And finally, number six, and this is the most important, it was the name that caused the least disagreement, the best of a bad bunch of names. Still, Bono hated it, but I guess he learned to live with it. And it turned out pretty good, huh? Okay, let's back up a second to the notion of a name lending itself to good graphic design. There were many myths and legends regarding the origins of the name Nine Inch Nails. Christ was crucified using spikes that were 9 inches long. Coffin nails are traditionally 9 inches long. Okay, that was nice, but like many people who dream of stardom, Trent Reznor used to doodle. And over the years, he had come up with close to 200 possible names for his future band. Each one was subjected to what he called his two-week rule. If he still liked the name after 2 weeks, he'd keep it. The only name to survive was Nine Inch Nails. This has no literal meaning. Sounds cool, sounds tough, sounds frightening, looks great in print. It could be nicely abbreviated, you know, N-I-N. And the logo design possibilities for Nine Inch Nails and N-I-N were very, very good. So, Nine Inch Nails it was. Sorry that the story isn't more interesting than that, but that's the truth. Head Like a Hole from Nine Inch Nails. Great name, but its origins are rooted in nothing but nonsense. Same thing with the Arctic Monkeys. Pretty good band. Lots of success with their first album. Plenty of critical acclaim, but an awful, awful name. I mean, Arctic Monkeys? I mean, really, what kind of drugs did you take to come up with something that bad? The truth is that guitarist Jamie Cook is credited with coming up with the name out of nowhere while daydreaming in high school. Just like Trent Reznor, he spent a lot of time doodling potential band names in the back of his notebooks when he should have been paying attention in history class. One day, for no particular reason, he wrote out Arctic Monkeys. And when it came time for him and neighbor Alex Turner to form a group, they went with that. I wish there was a better explanation, but there just isn't. Now, there are stories that they borrowed the name from a relative. Drummer Matt Helder says it was his dad. No, wait. It was his uncle who used to be in a band in the 70s called Arctic Monkeys. Not true. They just made up a bunch of stories when they started to get famous to mess with the press. Still, yeah, I don't care what you say, it's an awful name. But, hey, whatever works, right? It goes to show that it's impossible to predict how the public will react to the name that you choose for your group. The Arctic Monkeys, a nonsense name that works. And it's not the only one. Take the name Alice in Chains. It came about after a night of heavy drinking and toking. Singer Lane Staley thought that it would be a funny name for a glam punk band. He meant it as a joke, but when the group actually got going, it was the only name that everybody seemed to tolerate. The name Smashing Pumpkins came out of a conversation that Billy Corgan was having in someone's kitchen one night. Pumpkins, you have to admit, is kind of a funny word, and if you're English from the UK, smashing means very good. Put the two together and you have a band name that everyone can remember. They played one gig under that name and felt obligated to keep it. The Butthole Surfers went by a variety of stupid names that were chosen for their very stupidity. They came up with a new name for every single gig, and then one night they introduced themselves as the Butthole Surfers, and it stuck. The audience ate it up, so they were more or less tagged with that name forever. Which just goes to show, kids, that you really need to be very careful when choosing a name for your band because the joke just might backfire. Back with more in a second.
This is the ongoing history of new music. You're tuned to the ongoing history of new music.
This is part two of a show on band names, and we're trying to learn from the victories and mistakes other groups have made. This way, if you're ever in a group that's in search of a name, you'll at least have some kind of guidance. And once again, I gotta emphasize this, we have invented a word specifically for these programs, a word that describes the study of the origins of the names of musical groups. Bandominology. Again, lots of academics helped me with that, and we're going with it. Bandominology. Learn it, use it. One way to find the perfect name is to co-opt something from your daily life. Turn something ordinary into something interesting and extraordinary. Take Mike Krueger. Mike used to be a barista at a Starbucks in Vancouver. And at the time, many of his customers bought coffees that sold for $1.95 or $2.95 or $3.95 and so on. He spent a lot of time giving people 5 cents worth of change. So when Mike and his brother Chad were looking for a name for their new band, Mike remembered all the hours he spent giving people their nickel back. It's said that Breaking Benjamin is rooted in the fact that singer Benjamin Burley has a habit of breaking microphones. And the best story anyone's ever heard about the name Sum 41 is that the group was formed 41 days into the summer of 1996. Okay, what about Weezer? Well, before they came along, Rivers Cuomo had been in bands most of his life. They had names like Avant Garde, Zoom, 60 Wrong Sausages, and even considered Power Chicken at one point. When the band that was to become Weezer came together, they considered names like Outhouse, Meathead, This Niblet, and The Big Jones, but they all felt that those were pretty lame. Then they got a gig opening for Keanu Reeves and his band called Dogstar. You can open the show, the promoter said, but you need a name. And this is where Rivers pulled something out of his past. Rivers was born with one leg shorter than the other, something that he had corrected with surgery after the band started selling records by the millions. Now, with one leg shorter than the other meant that he wasn't exactly the most athletic or in shape of all the kids in his class. Complicating matters was a case of asthma. Add the two things together, and the kids at school nicknamed Rivers Weezer because he was always wheezing. They were only going to use the name for that one show with Dogstar, but because no one could think of anything better, the name stuck. So here we are with a multi-platinum band named after a guy who can't travel without an inhaler because of his respiratory problems. Another source of inspiration for band names can be real people. David Bowie's real name, for example, is David Jones. But in the middle 1960s, when he was still an unknown singer, he found himself competing for attention with Davy Jones, who's the cute little one in the band The Monkees. So David picked a new surname. He went with Bowie after the Bowie knife, a specially shaped knife designed by Colonel Jim Bowie, who used it in knife fights in southern Louisiana. It was also with him at the Battle of the Alamo in 1836. Now, he died. The knife didn't do him too much good, but the name of the knife lives on. Elvis Costello's real name is Declan McManus. The sources of the name Elvis is obvious. The Costello is his mother's maiden name. And the origins of Franz Ferdinand are obvious to anyone who studies history. The Archduke Franz Ferdinand took a trip to Sarajevo in what was the capital of Bosnia and Herzegovina on June 28, 1914. This turned out to be a very bad move. At around 11 that morning, he was shot and killed by a young guy named Gavrilo Princip. His assassination, coupled with a complicated series of European alliances, an arms race, and various flavors of nationalism, was the trigger for what became known as World War I. And yes, this Archduke is the inspiration behind the name for the band Franz Ferdinand. Here's one more example of a band taking their name from a real person. When Perry Farrell was trying to come up with a name for his new group, he had a lot of trouble. No one was feeling the names that he had suggested. They finally came up with something, but this requires a little bit of history. In late 1984, Perry rented a house on Wilton Street, 369 North Wilton, between Melrose and Beverly in Hollywood. Big place built in the 1920s. The landlords were a couple of motorcycle cops, Chips guys. and it became the hangout for refugees from the Hollywood glam goth scene. Up to a dozen musicians, photographers, and artists lived at what became known as Wilton House at any one time. And you can probably bet the cop landlords were really happy about that. Anyway, early 1985, a woman named Jane Bainter rented a room upstairs that connected directly to Perry's room through a porch. There are some stories that suggest that Jane was a hooker who used her earnings to finance Perry's musical aspirations in the early days. That appears to be completely untrue. Jane had a job at a management company in nearby Century City. Very, very straight-laced kind of job. But back at the house, Jane liked to party. She liked her drugs. However, it was her drug use that got her voted out of the house after about a year. Other than Perry, everybody wanted her out because of Jane's dependence on a variety of drugs. It was around this time that Perry's band, called Psycom, broke apart, and he was looking for a name for a new group. No one could come up with something sufficiently artsy until Casey Nicoli, Perry's girlfriend at the time, suggested Jane's heroin experience after Jane's well-known drug problems. Now, Perry thought the idea was good, but that Jane's heroin experience was too long. That's when it hit him. The new band would be called Jane's Addiction. Jane, for the record, wasn't too happy about this, but she went along with it anyway. Besides, Perry had already written a song about her when she lived at Wilton House. So, Jane's Addiction, it was.
And she starts to cry. She can't hurt. She don't mean no harm. She just don't know what else to do about it.
Doesn't sound all that different from the final version, but that's the original version of Jane Says from Jane's Addiction, recorded sometime in about 1987. And just so we're clear, the Jane in both the song and in the name of the band is Jane Bainter, a former housemate of Perry Farrell's. Here's another example of how real people can inspire names for bands. When Brian Warner started up his group in Florida, all the players had to adopt stage names. This was the rule. One name had to refer to a pop culture icon, and the other had to be from a serial killer or mass murderer. Hence the name Marilyn Manson, Marilyn Monroe, and Charles Manson. Then we have Twiggy Ramirez, Twiggy the model, and Richard Ramirez, the Night Stalker killer. Gidget Gein, Gidget, the wholesome Sally Field character from the 1960s, and Ed Gein, a guy who skinned and ate some of his victims. Other members have included Sarah Lee Lucas, Daisy Berkowitz, Madonna Wayne Gacy, and Olivia Newton-Bundy. Why go through this trouble? Something about displaying irony and the dichotomies between good and evil. Along those lines. Well, whatever. It worked. Let's clear up one more thing involving a real person and a band name. Jimmy Eat World is not code for anything. Some people suggested that if you take the initials of Jimmy Eat World, you get Jew, J-E-W, and hence a tribute to the religion of the band members. Well, not true, because, see, nobody in the band is Jewish. The name actually comes from a fight between guitarist Tom Linton's little brothers. One of them, Ed, drew a picture of Jimmy, who was on the pudgy and heavy side, eating the entire planet. And the caption of this kid's drawing was, Jimmy Eat World. Bad grammar, but therein lies the name of the band. When we come back, a final series of hints about naming your next band and how to make sure that you don't pick a name that somebody already has. Details in a sec.
This is the ongoing history of new music. You're tuned to the ongoing history of new music.
The number of potential names for your group is not infinite. It's kind of like notes on a scale. There are only so many pleasing combinations available. Someone may get to a certain name before you, and if they demonstrate sufficient usage of that name before you, they win, you lose. Take the case of Nirvana. Kurt Cobain thought that was a great name. What he didn't realize is that there already was a Nirvana. They were a British group with roots as far back as 1967, which was the year Kurt was born. When Kurt's Nirvana got big, the British Nirvana launched a lawsuit. Now, the whole thing was settled fairly amicably. The British Nirvana got a $25,000 buyout. And in 1996, they got back together just for fun and recorded a version of Lithium. So, case closed on that one. When R.E.M. settled on that name, there were at least six other bands calling themselves R.E.M. But because the Athens R.E.M. was the first to establish themselves in the eyes and ears of the general public, they won. And what about all the British bands that are tagged with UK or English or London? I mean, we got the Charlatans UK, Mission UK, English Beat, London Suede, and so on. Well, that's really quite simple. They were ordered to set themselves apart from American groups who already had that name. There already was a Charlatans, a Mission, and a The Beat. So it was change it or be sued. In the case of Suede in America, they had to bow to the wishes of an obscure lounge singer. I think she was from Denver. And that's why they're now known as London Suede in America. What are you going to do?
Now you're taking your time.
Here are examples of a few other nomenclature clashes. There was a cool Toronto band called Death From Above, but when a dance label from New York City called Death From Above objected, the Toronto guys had to add the 1979 to their name to avoid any unpleasantness. And the Stone Temple Pilots were once known as Mighty Joe Young, but there was already a bluesman with that name, so they tried to go with STP after somebody in the group spied a sticker for that oil treatment product. But then someone at the oil treatment company raised an eyebrow and cast a glance down the hall towards the legal department. So STP, the band, had to find something to fit the letters STP, which is where they came up with Stone Temple Pilots. Means nothing. It's a name of convenience. Strange, but true. Back with a few final words on naming your band, including how to make sure that when you do come up with a perfect name, no one else can steal it before you're ready to use it. This is very, very important, very helpful information. Don't go anywhere.
This is the ongoing history of new music. You're tuned to the ongoing history of new music.
Now, we've just spent two entire shows documenting the difficulties of finding that perfect name for a musical group. So let's say that you finally come up with a good one, a name that everyone in the group can agree upon. How can you ensure that no one has ever thought of it before? And how can you be sure that no one muscles in on your name before you're ready to bust out? Now, in the past, you just had to hope for the best. Go with the name and hope that when you do make it big, someone doesn't come out of somewhere and sue you to death for stealing their name. Or you could do a little research. Maybe you find the biggest record store that you could, and you look through all the racks to make sure that your name wasn't taken. Or you could also look at a big catalog of record releases, again, looking for your name, make sure it hasn't been taken. But today, it's much, much easier. Google searches, really easy. Allmusic.com, really easy. And there are registries like www.bandname.com. Since 1997, the people at bandname.com have been keeping track of who has what name for their group. They say that their worldwide band name registry is the most comprehensive on the planet, with more than 200,000 names on file. You can search to see if your name has already been taken, and if not, you can register it to make sure that no one takes it from you. They also offer suggestions about how you can protect yourself from being copied or ripped off. Take a look if you're in a band. www.bandname.com. Good luck. Thanks for listening, and remember to start using our new word that describes the origins of band names. We're calling it bandominology. Thanks to Dr. Sheila Embleton of York University and Mark Hershon of Simmer Branding in Sausalito, California, for their onomastical advice and input. I think we're onto something here. Please spread the word, and we'll get it into a dictionary somehow. Bandominology. Technical production by Anthony Conte and Rob Johnston. I'm Alan Cross.
You've been listening to The Ongoing History of New Music, a Deep Sky production.